poles. It has exactly two poles, so its denominator must be of the form S plus A into S plus B. Clue 2 says that it has no zeros in the finite S plane. That means its numerator polynomial must be a constant. I repeat it again. I am utilizing these two information simultaneously to find out what is the possible form of x of s. The possible form, of x of s from clues 1 and 2 is this, because one says it must have two poles and clue second says that it don't have any zeros in finite S plane, so S of S must have this form. Now clue 3 says that X of has a pole at S is equal to minus 1 plus J. X of one pole is given, and it is also given the signal xt is real signal. So a real signal will have always a complex conjugate pole. So this suggests that if one pole is this, the other pole will be complex conjugate. That means the other pole will be minus 1 minus j. So that way I know the value of what should be A and B. Now S is equal to minus 1 plus j. If I shift this to this side, it becomes A upon S plus 1 minus j. This from here, and from here it will become S plus 1 plus j. So x of s now becomes this. Now I repeat this problem because the students are really scared doing this, attempting even this sort of problem. From first two information, the first information says that x of s has exactly two poles. So in the denominator I must have two linear expression in S. I choose S plus A and S plus B. Then second clue says that X of S must have no zeros in the finite S plane. This requires that numerator polynomial must be a constant. So I have chosen A where A is a constant. So clue 1 and 2 suggest a possible form of X of S like this. Now clue 3 says X of S has a pole at S equal to minus 1 plus J. Along with this, I am utilizing the information that signal XT is a real signal. Any real signal will have complex conjugate pole. So the other pole must be a complex conjugate of this. That means other pole is given by this. Now I transpose this side to left hand side, I get S plus 1 minus J, which I wrote for this. And for this, if I shift this, then for this I wrote like this. Now A is a constant, it must be evaluated. To evaluate A, let us use the clue 5. Clue 5 says X of 0 must be 8. So let us put S equal to 0 here. Then I get S of 0, which is given to be 8. This is A upon 0 plus 1 minus J into 0 plus 1 plus J. Now if I simplify, let us simplify this. So this becomes 8 equal to A upon 1 minus J into 1 plus J. That means 1 plus j square minus j square. And you know minus j square is 1. So this becomes a upon 1 plus 1, that means a by 2. From here we get a equal to 16. Now x of s has clearly been this 16 upon s plus 1 minus j s plus 1 plus j. Let us simplify this. So this minus this, this minus this, suppose this is x and this is y. So I can read it x minus y into x plus y. That should be x square minus y square. That means 16 upon s plus 1 square minus j square. Let's simplify it. So x of s becomes 16 upon s square plus 2s plus 1, j square is minus 1. So this becomes plus 1. So 16 upon s square plus 2s plus 2. This becomes the Laplace transform of the signal xt. That was required, but along with this, we are required is ROC also. For to determine this ROC, a clue is given, clue number 4. Clue number 4, that e raised power 2t xt is not absolutely integrable. Integrable. This means the ROC, this implies ROC of this cannot include j omega axis. You can draw the conclusion from clue number 4 that ROC of x of s cannot include j omega axis. Now we had poles at s is equal to minus 1 minus j and at s is equal to minus 1 plus j. That means this ROC must be real of s greater than minus 1. If ROC is real of s greater than minus 1, then j omega axis will not be included. So the conclusion is that x of s required is this and ROC is real of s greater than minus 1. So what a simple problem. It looks to be quite involved, but it's a very simple, provided we invoke the information correctly. Now let's do problem number 9.54. Problem number 9.54. This is again from your, this problem is again from your book, and it says consider a real value signal xt and its Laplace transform is given to be x of s. Then we have to prove that xt is a real value signal. Xt is a real signal. Then for the first part we have to prove that x of s is x conjugate s conjugate. This is the first part. Let's do the first part, then we'll come to second. You'll see from your book that this problem 9.54 is listed in the category of advanced problem. So, seeing the word advanced, you may get scared of, but it is so simple. Let us write this, use this equation to prove this. X of s from here is x t e to the power minus s t dt. So, I have expressed the Laplace transform of x t in terms of x of s. Now, we have got this thing in mind, x t is a real signal. Now, if x t is real, then x t is same as x conjugate t. Take a real number, say 3, its conjugate is 3 again. So, if a signal is real, it must be equal to its conjugate. So, let us try to find out what is the Fourier transform of this. To get the Fourier transform of this, let us take complex conjugate of both sides. Let us take the complex conjugate of both sides. So, that way we become x conjugate s, this is x conjugate t e raised power, this is what we get. Now, if I compare these two in the definition of Laplace transform, this would be e of minus s t and this is x conjugate. So, unless this becomes e raised to power minus st, we cannot say that this is the transform of this. So, to take care of this, let us replace s by, yeah, let us do this operation. S is replaced by s conjugate and s conjugate is replaced by s. If we do that, then what we get is x conjugate, s conjugate, this becomes minus infinity to infinity x conjugate t e raised for minus s conjugate replaced by s. So, s t dt. Now, we can compare these two, we can try to match these two. Now, we can say since these two are same, we can say that the Laplace transform of this is x for this. So, this proves that x of s for a real signal x t, x of s is same as x conjugate, s conjugate. So, part 1 is achieved and so simple. Let us go for the part B. Part B. It shows, it says that so that if x of s has a pole 0 at s is equal to s naught, it must have a pole 0 at s is equal to s naught complex for xt real, for real xt. We have already determined the case for real xt. Now let us see how now to do this, let us assume that x of s has a 0 at s equal to s1. Assume x of s has a 0 at s equal to s1. That means s of s1 will be 0. And since xt is real, we should have s of x1 is equal to x complex s1 complex. This form be part 1. Now since x of s1 is 0, since x of s1 is 0, this implies from here that x conjugate s1 conjugate is 0. Now let's take complex conjugate of both sides. Take complex conjugate of both the sides. Then this becomes x. What does it imply? It implies that if s1 is a 0 of this, then s1 complex is a 0 of this. This says that s1 complex is also a 0 of x of s. This proves that if x t is a real signal, then its zeros occur in conjugate pairs. Likewise, we can prove for the poles also. Poles, we can show that they appear in conjugate pairs. Now, if time permits, we can continue doing more problems in general on Laplace transform. Let's take another important aspect of Laplace transform, which is called unilateral Laplace transform. Laplace transform, which is called unilateral Laplace transform. Unilateral Laplace transform or one-sided Laplace transform. Earlier, whatever we discussed, it was a two-sided Laplace transform. Now we intend to discuss one-sided Laplace transform. In two-sided Laplace transform, let me reproduce it, rewrite it for your ready reference. Here xt may exist in entire time domain from minus infinity to infinity. That means the limit for t becomes minus infinity to infinity. It is for bilateral Laplace transform. Bilateral Laplace transform. Now, we want to discuss unilateral Laplace transform. So, in time domain, suppose t equal to 0, for unilateral Laplace transform or one sided Laplace transform, we consider the range of integration from t equal to 0 to infinity. So, the unilateral Laplace transform of a signal xt is defined as integration 0 minus to infinity xt e raised power minus st dt x of s. Here 0 minus indicates that if signal has got any initial condition, then it can account that. That means it relates with the memory of the signal. If signal has got any memory prior to t equal to 0, it accounts that.